10's Late News with Natasha Belling.
Tonight, frightening scenes as Kurdish protesters and police clash in Sydney. Low-down, backstabbing rats. That's what American marching bands think of us. And the face of a millionaire 75 times over. Good evening. First tonight, a wild brawl between police and Kurdish demonstrators outside the Turkish consulate in Sydney.
Police and Kurdish protesters battle it out on the streets of Sydney. Mayhem as officers move to clear angry demonstrators from a busy street.
Get back! Get back!
Screaming protesters drag to the footpath as police try to arrest the troublemakers.
Leave me alone! Leave me alone!
With their colleagues fending off the screaming Kurds, police desperately bundle the arrested into paddy wagons.
Put no one to blame but yourself.
What you were thinking?
She bit somebody.
No.
She bit a police officer.
You bit a lot of
us.
You bit a lot of us. Look what he did with us.
Some fighting tooth and nail for freedom, tempers are at flashpoint. Others surround the paddy wagons, blocking their exit. The roadside rumble outside the Turkish consulate began as a protest against the death sentence handed out to Kurdish rebel leader Abdullah Öcalan.
The protesters were in the midst of packing up and ending their demonstration when an aerial was broken off a police vehicle. It was then officers moved in and made the arrests.
Minutes earlier, the protesters tried to invade the consulate. Four demonstrators were arrested. They're expected to face charges ranging from assault to malicious damage. Sean Fuentes, 10 News.
And more violence, this time near Melbourne. A slur about a teenage girl's weight starting a gang fight, injuring six young people. This metal claw was used on an 18-year-old girl, one of 30 teenagers involved in the fight. Police say it broke out after a dance party in Dandenong. Garden stakes, club locks, knives, bottles and chunks of metal bars were just some of the weapons used. And unrest on the streets of Jakarta. Police have beaten and shot at protesters who say last month's election was corrupt.
It's the sort of violence the world had expected during the June elections. Now, with only half the vote counted, impatience has boiled over on the streets, protesters clashing with police. Hundreds of demonstrators from the left-wing People's Democratic Party tried to break a police cordon outside the Electoral Commission in the Indonesian capital. They want the ruling Golkar Party disqualified from the count, claiming it cheated. Golkar is running second so far. Police fired tear gas into the crowd, which fought back with bottles and rocks. With plastic bullets fired randomly into the crowd, at least one man was hit, another 15 injured. With the vote count continuing, Indonesian authorities are calling for patience. A final result still weeks away. Deborah Knight, 10 News.
Tributes tonight for another political heavyweight stepping from the spotlight. Liberal Party President Tony Staley is handing over to the Northern Territory's Shane Stone.
Prime Minister John Howard arrived at tonight's Federal Council to farewell a mate.
Seems to be a week in which number of people who've been around for a long time go.
Party President Tony Staley departing after 6 years, having helped steer the party through the devastating 1993 election loss to a GST victory.
That John, you are indisputably the Liberal Party's greatest leader since our founder Sir Robert Menzies.
His successor, former Northern Territory Chief Minister Shane Stone.
Well, it's a very different style. I come with the background of having been a state president of a political party as well as a head of government.
And as Tony Staley prepares to depart the political spotlight, tributes too for outgoing National Party leader Tim Fischer. But the wrangling over how to fill Tim Fischer's trade portfolio continues.
No, we'll be talking about that later.
With National Party leader John Anderson and Deputy Mark Vaile reluctant to take on the portfolio, business leaders are urging against the appointment of a junior minister.
I think it's critically important that we have someone who can hit the ground running, who has the confidence of the business community.
We have a major problem and they can't make up their mind. Mr. Anderson should step up, take the job and do it.
Samantha Maiden, 10 News.
A famous key from the French Revolution is back in safe hands in Sydney tonight. The key that opened the door to Paris's Bastille prison 2 centuries ago, sparking the French Revolution, was stolen from a Madame Tussauds exhibition in Sydney. But then the thief had an attack of conscience, the unidentified man tonight handing it over to police. Shock news from Wimbledon tonight. A knee injury has forced Australian Mark Philippoussis out of the championship. And we'll have the full details in sports tonight with Bill Woods. Australians have been labelled a bunch of low-down backstabbing rats as the Olympic marching band row spreads across the US. Americans are being urged to take it out on the Sydney Games by boycotting Australia.
Australian Consulate General and Tourist Commission, good afternoon.
The phones were running hot at Australia's US consulates.
So I think since this morning we've had over 50 phone calls.
Angry callers egged on by a scathing piece in the local paper titled Time to Fire Up the Barbie and Put Aussies on It. It calls us a bunch of low-down backstabbing rats.
It's almost a slap in the face. I don't understand it. I'm really confused.
Band organiser Roy Anthony is heading to Sydney next week to plead the students' case, but legal action and public backlash may force SOCOG to offer the Americans a consolation prize of a chance to perform in another Olympic setting, but that'll mean they may not need their I'm going to Sydney t-shirts because officials here are unlikely to give them permission to take time off school for anything but the opening ceremony.
I can't understand for 7 minutes of an opening ceremony to say, you cannot come, we only want to do our own thing.
The Prime Minister bought into the embarrassment today.
There's a little doubt in my mind that the right decision has now been made. It's a pity it slipped through earlier on and these expectations were raised.
Besides the calls and letters, the groundswell of anger is yet to lead to the rumoured pickets. But some Californian business people are making protests of their own.
Travel consultant Maureen Onstad is telling clients to holiday elsewhere.
When you start going for our kids, you better watch out. I think that as a mom and a grandma, I'm telling you, you can't hurt our kids. you better stand back.
Michelle Stone in Los Angeles, 10 News.
Next in the late news, Robert Hughes' high-flying homecoming. A killer disaster in an Argentine level crossing. Dressing for success without spending a cent.
It's going to be a lot of testosterone flying around here today.
He goes by the book.
The Rock and Archie Show.
But before it's all over,
he acts like a cop.
He'll break all the rules.
Archie Mulder's under arrest.
Now, the only person he can trust.
What are you getting sweet on this guy?
Is the man he betrayed. Adam Sandler, Damon Wayans.
You'll always be my bodyguard.
For the first time, 8:30 Sunday on 10, Bulletproof.
All for tomorrow? No worries.
Brother understands that being in business for yourself isn't always an easy ride. You really have your ups and your downs. That's why you need the best office equipment to help you along the way. It's true you can't always rely on every job to run as smoothly as you'd like. But you can always rely on your brother.
We really love our new city apartment. The architect's done such a good job. It's modern and it's got great finishes. It's got a fabulous designer kitchen and I just adore our dining room. But do you know what the best part is? Oh, thanks. Our apartment's up there and the city's right down here.
Paragon CBD Apartments, Perth's first truly affordable city apartment, pre-selling from $162,000.
Stick a McMatch and Win Monopoly game sticker on Bond Street, and in an instant, you're playing to win $50,000 in cash from Aussie Home Loans.
That beats second prize in a beauty contest. All you have to do is collect Regent, Bond and Oxford Street, stick them down, and it's like
advance to go.
Collect 50 grand.
Hey, mate. Buy yourself a bigger house.
McMatch and Win Monopoly. Stick around. This is big.
Metal bars designed to save your neck.
Designed to save your skin. The revolutionary Schick Protector 3D with ultra-thin safety wires. Now that feels good. Schick Protector 3D. The feel of smart design.
Clark's $10 to $40 off. Sandler, DF Supersoft and Rocks $10 to $20 off. Dakota, Winsor Smith and Hush Puppies $10 to $30 off. Big names, big savings. Bets and Bets famous name sale. Hurry, ends this weekend.
Art critic Robert Hughes has been airlifted to Sydney from Perth as he continues to recover from a serious road accident. He was flown by private jet to a Sydney hospital tonight to be closer to relatives and friends. 6 months after cruel seas shattered the Sydney Hobart fleet, the coroner has formally declared dead those still missing. But the full inquest is still months away.
This will be the most searching probe yet into the Sydney Hobart tragedy that claimed six lives. Every aspect of the disastrous race and the subsequent rescues will be examined in the hope of preventing more losses in future. For the families of those who perished in the wild seas, today's hearing an important part of the grieving process. And they still want answers.
Just exactly how a life raft in those sort of seas would react, and to try and ascertain exactly what went wrong with equipment.
Michael Bannister, one of those drowned when his raft was swamped. Crew members from the Winston Churchill, the last to see him alive. The coroner decreed all six victims died by drowning. A legal move especially important for the families of Englishman Glyn Charles and Sydney yachtsman John Dean, whose bodies have never been found. Under the spotlight, weather reports before and during the race, the organisation of the event, safety equipment, communications, the experience level of crews, and the effects of chronic seasickness.
Nobody likes to see the death, particularly six people in one race. And it was obviously, there's a flaws in the system.
A key issue, whether the yachts themselves could withstand such massive seas.
The trend in yacht design has been to sacrifice strength for speed, building boats using lightweight materials. The question the inquiry will have to answer is whether that trend is putting lives at risk.
The coroner's ordered stability tests on several of the yachts that did survive the race. John Hill, 10 News.
Three men arrested over bodies found at a South Australian bank vault are now officially accused of being serial killers. They were first charged with one death until today, when new charges were laid over nine other murders.
Only John Bunting chose to be present as the court was told of the new charges. He's now charged with 10 counts of murder, along with Robert Wagner and Mark Hayden. James Vlasakis, who's only appeared in a bedside sitting at Glenside Hospital so far, remains charged with one. Court documents reveal the charges include the murder of Barry Lane, Elizabeth Hayden, Troy Ude, Michael Gardner, Gavin Porter, Gary O'Dwyer, Fred Brooks, and a man whose name is suppressed. Their bodies were found in a Snowtown bank vault. The 10th charge relates to the death of Suzanne Allen, whose body was found in a Salisbury North backyard. The charges allege the murders occurred between January 1, 1995 and May 21 this year, but they don't say the exact locations. Director of Public Prosecutions Paul Rowe said 21 witness statements have been provided to the defence, but police are expecting to need a further 12 weeks to complete their investigations. It's anticipated the men will be able to formally answer the charges a month later. Lawyers for the men ask that no court documents be released to the media. They also ask that images of the men be completely suppressed. Mark Griffin, for Bunting, said a witness allegedly identified his client by his physique. Magistrate David Gurry granted the order and also excused Hayden and Wagner from appearing on the next court date, October 5. Fiona Clark, 10 News.
A former champion athlete has been convicted of stalking one of Australia's top cross-country skiers. Robin Rishworth stalked Belinda Phillips in the hope she'd become his girlfriend, but he says he's the victim.
33-year-old athlete Robin Rishworth is accustomed to winning, so today's court loss was difficult to accept. A magistrate found he stalked cross-country skier Belinda Phillips for more than 2 years to nightmarish proportions.
I've got nothing to apologise because I never intended to do any harm. It's as simple as that.
He's won the prestigious Empire State Building stair climb and Melbourne's Rialto Tower run-up. But the court heard his romantic feats weren't so successful. Attempts to make Miss Phillips his girlfriend soon turned to stalking.
I feel relieved that it's happened, that it's all come out in the open.
Belinda, who is ranked number 5 cross-country skier in the country, says her training has been greatly affected by the ordeal. The court heard he followed her constantly, even spying on her during remote country camping trips. The magistrate ruled Mr. Rishworth continued this behaviour despite Miss Phillips' clear refusals, and that his threats to kill himself were efforts to attain sympathy. The magistrate described Miss Phillips as an honest and courageous witness who gave her evidence quietly, confidently, and without embellishment. He described Mr. Rishworth as aggressive, antagonistic, and quick to quarrel with counsel. Despite these comments, Mr. Rishworth claims he's the victim.
The media have cut me to pieces, and I don't want to hurt anyone. Long term, I've got to forgive what was said in court and ultimately be civil to this family.
The magistrate has ordered he undergo psychiatric assessment before sentencing. Kim Carter, 10 News.
A fiery rail collision has left 3 people dead in Argentina. A passenger train ploughed into a petrol tanker as it crossed the tracks. Witnesses say the train driver repeatedly sounded his horn as he approached. The 2 drivers of the train and the truck driver died in the explosion. The train was derailed, but no passengers were injured. Next in 10's Late News, dressing for success without spending a cent. The face of a millionaire 75 times over. And in Sports Tonight, injury forces the Scud out of Wimbledon.
Scott's travelling first class.
I'm driving the heaviest, longest train in the world.
With Sleeper.
I'll come back in a moment for the other one.
On a journey across the Nullarbor to explore the beautiful Golden West.
Pure magic.
Railway adventures across Australia, 7:30 Saturday.
What's the plan, boss?
It's a $15 plan.
What?
Look, buy one of these here phones at Telstra Shop or Connections for $15 a month, which includes $10 worth of free calls.
So if I make $10 worth of calls a month, effectively, my monthly access cost is like $5.
Effectively, Nigel, that is correct.
All that and the $50 gift voucher?
So get into a Telstra Shop now.
Freeze. It's a steal.
Out here, your nearest neighbors are clouds. That's good because clouds never complain about the noise. My best friend lives 40 miles that way. That's probably why we're so close. You can get lost out here if you try hard enough. Drop by sometime. Jack lives here.
Plane tickets to the town where she was born, $4,800. Train to the house where she grew up, $120. Pints at the pub where she met your dad, $8. Finally understanding where your mother was coming from? Priceless. There are some things money can't buy. For everything else, there's MasterCard. Accept it all over. Even pubs in Ireland.
I stuck a McDonald's McMatch and Win Monopoly game sticker on Trafalgar Square, and who knows, I could win a family holiday
to Disneyland. It's the happiest place on earth. All flying air New Zealand. Hey, Mum, do you want the beef or the chicken?
Talk about community test. Go back 3 paces. All you have to do is collect all 3 red streaks, stick them down, and you might as well be in Main Street, USA. That's in Disneyland. McMatch and Win Monopoly. Stick around. This is big.
Top lawyers have condemned planned industrial relations reforms, calling them unfair and unbalanced. Tonight, the government hit back, claiming the campaign is politically motivated.
Denying any Labor Party affiliation, Kevin Bell says moral outrage was the driving force behind his hastily assembled lobby group.
We are not just guns for hire. Lawyers have an ethical obligation to stand up and be counted where, from the point of view of their own practical experience, they can see an injustice being done.
More than 80 industrial lawyers have signed a critique on the government's latest proposed reforms. They say the changes would attack the system's fairness and integrity, in particular, the government's ability to choose the length of appointments for industrial relations commissioners.
The present act guarantees life tenure to members of the Industrial Relations Commission. The proposed bill will allow the government to introduce 7-year terms for new members of the commission. That is a fundamental attack upon the independence of the commission.
We have had, of course, in the past, fixed term appointments. The last president of the commission was appointed for a fixed term by a Labor government. There weren't 70 lawyers then saying this was a undermining of the independence of the commission.
Mr. Reith says some of the signatories to the lawyers' report are current and former Labor state MPs, compromising their credibility. He's denied that the streamlining of awards has stripped workers of their rights, saying the proposed changes would make the system more balanced and democratic.
The group's best chance of making an impact is to persuade the Democrats to harden their line on industrial relations policy and oppose this round of reforms. The lawyers also hope to make a submission to the Senate committee studying the proposed changes. Mary Geeran, 10 News.
High technology is giving the wheelchair-bound a mobility never thought possible. It's a revolutionary go-anywhere wheelchair being made in the US.
It's the Rolls-Royce of the wheelchair world.
It is an extraordinary machine that allows people to do ordinary things.
Stairs are no problem to the battery-powered Independence 3000. It uses sensors to adjust for movement of the seat and centre of gravity. Curbs are no problem either. Built-in computers keep the occupant balanced at all times. Even sand is no obstacle. For the first time, a visit to the beach is a prospect for the wheelchair-bound. Best trick of all, up on two wheels, courtesy of an onboard gyroscope.
They can get where everybody else can get, and that's just, it's really an emotional thing to see.
Johnson & Johnson say it should be on the market in about 2 years for around $50,000. Andrea Clark, 10 News.
In finance, and the Australian shares finished higher today. The benchmark All Ordinaries Index closing up 27 points. Among the stocks, Telstra's gained 6, AMP was up 33, and Rio Tinto climbed 45. In banking, the Commonwealth rose 25, Westpac 7, St George lost 12 cents. The Aussie dollar will tonight buy you 66.73 US cents, 42.34 pence, 80.58 yen and 0.6508 euro. Gold is trading at $262.75 an ounce, and in early trading the FT100 is down 9 points. Hong Kong's Hang Seng finished the day up 652 points, and Tokyo's Nikkei was up 72. She's only 21, but it's already all fallen into place for a very lucky American woman. Her numbers came up in a record-breaking Powerball draw. Farris Ladd is still coping with the shock of winning a prize worth more than $75 million Australian, and that's after tax.
We looked it over 100 times, and it just didn't seem real. I'm still shocked.
And Farah's not going to quit her job just yet, but she does have some plans for the money, a new car, a house, and a trip to Mexico. Got a job interview, but not a stitch to wear? A Melbourne job agency has opened a clothing library so you can dress for success without spending a cent.
Much like any suburban library, clients are allowed to browse and select at their pleasure. But instead of books, this facility stocks business suits, shirts, shoes and ties. It's been designed to put the unemployed on an equal footing when presenting face-to-face for an interview.
They just come in with a referral letter, borrow the clothing they need for the interview and return it in a day or two. It's no cost to the job seeker whatsoever.
Menswear has been available for the past 2 weeks and ladieswear will arrive later this month. Already the service has gained the approval of many clients, including 54-year-old Barry Stannard, who is searching for clerical work.
Very important, make sure you've got a tie on, collar, suit. They look very nice and very relaxed and very professional.
Helps with people's self-esteem when they're walking into an interview if they feel they look good. And research has shown that the first 10 or 20 seconds is really important in making a good impression.
Donated by manufacturers and retailers, the clothes and shoes are all brand new. Many still have the designer labels attached.
Determined to make the service user-friendly, staff are happy to offer fashion advice, and there's even a chart which explains how to tie a tie.
At least six other clothing libraries have also opened in the southeastern suburbs and all include free dry cleaning and repairs. Tracy Kirkland, 10 News.
In other news tonight, an Aussie beer has cleaned up at a world championship in Melbourne. Han Premium Lager was named Grand Champion Beer of 1999, beating beers from 22 other countries. Stay with us, still to come, the National Weather Report, then it's Sports Tonight with Bill Woods.
Thank you, Natasha. Coming up on the show, finally, the sun is shining at Wimbledon. We'll have all the AFL and NRL news and action, plus surfers up in South Africa.
At the special adult time of 9:30 Saturday.
If ever there's another man, take him.
Based on the most controversial love story ever written.
Say you'll never break it off between us.
The original uncensored version of Lady Chatterley's Lover. Saturday on 10.
Can I
help? New Elantra.
Great.
Yes, it's a wonderful...
Big 1.8 litre twin cam.
There's a...
No, no, don't tell me.
There's a 2 litre model too.
There's...
And the sports wagon.
Well... Remote central locking, power
yes.
steering...
Power steering.
Aircon, CD player, power windows. Yes.
There's...
Warranty?
Well, there's...
5 years. Mister, you talked me into it.
At 19,990 drive away, the new Hyundai Elantra sells itself.
So, what's the plan, boss?
It's a $15 plan.
What?
Look, buy one of these here phones at a Telstra shop or Connectures for $15 a month, which includes $10 worth of free calls.
So if I make $10 worth of calls a month, effectively, my monthly access cost is like $5.
Effectively, Nigel, that is correct.
All that and the $50 gift voucher?
So get into a Telstra shop now.
It's a steal.
I'm playing McDonald's McMatch and Win Monopoly. All you have to do is buy a hash brown, peel off a game sticker, stick it on a Monopoly street, and you could win a Honda HR-V Sport. Let me tell you, beats me old set of wheels. All you have to do is collect Park Lane and Mayfair from McDonald's packs, stick them down, and Bob's your rich uncle. Hey, I thought this was free parking. McMatch and Win Monopoly. Stick around. This is big.
You can drive 20 kilometres from Perth and end up here, or you can end up here. Jane Brook Residential Estate, a home in the beautiful Swan Valley, just 20 kilometres from the city. Generous, elevated home sites surrounded by nature, priced from $55,000. Jane Brook Private Estate. The choice is yours.
Now to the national weather. And the latest satellite picture shows a band of mid-level cloud across the northern tropics, slowly clearing eastwards. Cloud also extends over the southeast. On the weather map for tomorrow, there's a strong high-pressure system moving across Victoria and a cold front approaching the Western Australian coastline. So looking ahead and for tomorrow, a mostly fine day in Cairns and Townsville, fine also in Brisbane. Fine and windy for Sydney, fine but frosty in Canberra, showers clearing in Melbourne, Hobart fine, morning cloud for Adelaide and fine conditions in Perth, Darwin and the Alice. And that's the late news for now, but stay with us for Sports Tonight with Bill Woods. I'm Natasha Belling. Thanks for joining us. Enjoy your weekend. Good night.
Tonight's late night news brought to you by Holden and Brother, the best office equipment to help you get along the way.
They're getting up close and very personal.
I wouldn't do that. I was playing with that before.
But nothing will prepare you.
Be afraid.
For when Andrew Denton guest stars.
He's funny.
Good News Week, 7:30 Sunday on 10.
Tonight, Once again, we'll have Wimbledon covered. Let's hope the groundkeepers don't. A test for the Eels and the Storm, just who is the real deal? And can the Magpies deny the power points? Hello, I'm Bill Woods. This is Sports Tonight, and we're taking a dive into the World Tour's South African safari. Daniel in the lion's den. He won't give up on gold. And it's extreme heat on the streets in the USA. First up, the rain was gone and they finally saw some sun and grass at Wimbledon on day 11, but the shocks kept coming. Mark Philippoussis pulled out of his quarterfinal with world number one Pete Sampras after injuring his knee. All the more painful because he was leading one set to love. That left Pat Rafter and Yelena Dokic.
A new day and a new approach from Todd Martin, but the same old magic from Pat Rafter.
Beautiful shot. Back to the net.
The Queenslander stretched to the limit before winning the first set 6-4. But the eighth seed kept at it in the second, and he finally found a way past.
Great shot. Beautiful half volley from Martin.
In the second set tiebreaker, Rafter had the luck.
A little fortunate there.
But Martin's first serve proved decisive, the American taking it 7-5. The second seed struggled with his first serve and the frustration was apparent.
He's missed it.
On centre court, disaster for Mark Philippoussis against Pete Sampras after winning the first set 6-4. The scud was forced to retire with a knee injury. The Victorian received courtside treatment for several minutes, but was unable to continue. He said later he heard something click in his left knee and knew it was serious.
He was thinking he could win this event, and the way he was playing, he had every right to do that.
Philippoussis ended up in hospital to determine the extent of his injury. Rafter won the third set in a tiebreaker. We'll keep you updated on that one. Yelena Dokic should be on court pretty soon to resume her match. Steffi Graf is just one more win away from another Wimbledon final, while a confident Lindsay Davenport also through to the semis.
When the draw came out, or when the tournament started, I believed I could win it. You know, whether other people believe that or other people say that, you know, I can't control. But yeah, I mean, on grass, if you have a big game on grass, you're a good grass courter because it's hard to get those balls back, especially in women's tennis.
I wouldn't really say that I couldn't get into the match. I think it was a combination of things. I think that playing Lindsay Davenport is never easy, and obviously I do struggle with her, and today was no exception.
Now I'm extremely happy that I went out there and I played my game. I went for my shots. And, you know, obviously you get tired at certain situations, but we played unbelievable tennis, and that was counts to me.
I played well. Basically, I could have played better, especially on some key points, but it's too late to change anything I've done. I can just change for the future.
AFL, and while Collingwood fights on for its own reasons, Port Adelaide is in the middle of a stampede for the top eight. From here to the semi-finals, points will be precious. And for the Power, they were expected to come easily tonight.
Kick more than four goals. In slippery conditions at the MCG, Savrocker kicked the first goal for Collingwood.
He's kicked it pretty well. He likes it as a goal.
A free kick to Brett Chalmers, and Port Adelaide were back in front. But the Pies shot to the lead again with goals to Glenn Freeborn and Chris Tarrant.
From about 50 metres, he's got the goal! That came back beautifully!
The Power lost Adam Kingsley with an eye injury, but Gavin Wanganeen led from the front. A goal to Gavin Brown, and Rocker's second saw the Pies slip away to a 21-point lead. But Chalmers' second and a late goal to Nathan Eagleton cut the lead to 7 points at the first break.
Magnificent kick, that's a goal! No doubt about that!
An early miss from Port and another long goal to Freeborn gave the Pies six straight and a 12-point break. A huge leap from Chris Tarrant.
He is an exciting young player, this boy.
But the first blemish for the Pies. But from then on, Port wouldn't let the Pies slip away. The skippers were inspirational. First Buckley gold, then Wanganeen. Shane Bond squaring the game.
Bond's kick is a beauty.
Both teams trading goals in the dying minutes of the half, but unable to break the deadlock. It was all one-way traffic in the third quarter. The Pies unable to score a goal. The Power scooting away to a handy lead as the rain fell. But the Pies would never lie down. Three late goals gave them a chance, but time beating them. Port hanging on for a desperate one-point win and a spot in the eight.
Oh, they were so close, but in the end, that two-point third quarter from the Pies came back to haunt them. Freeborn kicked four, Port shared the spoils, Wanganeen best with just two. Another heavyweight confrontation tonight in the NRL, the kind of match you have to win if you're to be considered a title contender. Parramatta flew to Melbourne's Olympic Park to find out what pressure is all about.
Melbourne halfback Brett Camorley was again the focal point of the storm. His opposite number David Penner, equally impressive with the boot. Daniel Waggon enjoying the high road.
Jumpers and Parramatta's come down with it. The tall Daniel Waggon has put Nathan Hindmarsh over. Hindmarsh is in, first try of the game.
Parramatta captain Dean Pay took a harder line with a delicate touch. Penner five-star support, 12-0 after 21 minutes.
Through a gap, Penner support. Penner's on his way, he'll score. David Penner puts it down for Parramatta's second try.
Slippery Eels' grip on the match tightened 8 minutes before half-time. Jason Smith's boot bringing their third.
The kick has been regathered by Penner. Smith waits for him, gets it across the back. Morgan floats the pass. Luke Burt's heading for the corner with support. Doesn't need support. He's over in the corner.
Parramatta's start overwhelming Melbourne's biggest names. The Storm's handling another low point.
Another lost ball here. That's about the fifth or sixth time they've lost the ball.
Down 18-0 at the break, Melbourne couldn't shake a bad habit.
Now Martin.
Another forward.
And again forward to him.
While first-half hero Penner had a new problem, stability. Clinton Schavovsky steady, 20-0 Parramatta.
Looking for four from four and just getting it.
Rookie teammate Luke Burt on shaky ground before the Storm finally broke through Parramatta's brick wall defence with 5 minutes remaining.
Put a mark on the defensive line, they've done it. Robbie Ross has put it over the line.
But the winning foundation was already in place. The Eels cruising to their third straight win.
And the Storm under threat now, depending on other results, they could fall to as low as seventh on the ladder after this round and in danger of falling out of the playoff chase. The Eels, well, they could be as high as third.
Tonight we probably weren't quite as awesome as last week, but we were playing against a team, I thought, with, a lot more attacking options in their game, so you've got to be a little bit more wary.
Yeah, look, they did a lot of talking during the week. Then we saw what they did to the Cronulla, but I thought we matched them in the toughness department. They just worked very hard and worked very well as a unit, and we had to work very hard for 75 minutes to score a try.
Netball and the Melbourne Kestrels played Sydney Sandpipers in round 11 of the Commonwealth Bank Trophy. No matter how hard they tried, the Kestrels could not shake the Pipers in the first quarter. But with Jenny Borlase on fire, the Kestrels soon took flight. The Sandpipers struggled. Joe Morgan kept the score respectable. With Borlase shooting above 90%, though, the Kestrels lead ballooned.
Borlase really is unstoppable this evening.
The Kestrels just too quick in the final quarter. 12 goal winners, but what about the local derby between the Thunderbirds and the Ravens? Nothing separating those teams at full time. Opening round of the Men's National Hockey League, the Blades beat the Territory Stingers, the Perth Thundersticks upset Canberra, and that was in Canberra. This is Sports Tonight, where the surf is always up. Let's go now. Yeah.
This is one surf and safari that could change the world title. Was Daniel Kowalski born at the wrong time?
It'd be pointless, and it would just seem like a waste of my whole life if I decided just to throw it in.
And we head north for the dirtiest downhill event of all.
It's going to be a lot of testosterone flying around here today.
To the Rock and Archie show.
He acts like a cop.
Archie Mulder's under arrest.
Sweet honest guy.
Will you shut up?
You'll always be my bodyguard.
8:30 Sunday on 10. Bulletproof. 2, 3, 4.
Hear you.
either play music, listen to music, or move to Utah. Billy got kicked out of music school. That's kind of why we hired him.
One, two, three, four.
Sometimes daylight seems out of place here, but it does let you get some sleep. There's no better place to be exactly who you are. Drop by sometime. Jack lives here.
It's Rowan Jarman's traditional stock take sale with even bigger store-wide savings. Russell Athletic, save $40. Asics Junior Sweats and Pants, only $15. And Nike Air, save a huge $50. The traditional stock take sale, on now at Rowan Jarman Sports Superstores.
This is Domino's Stockman's Pizza. Ain't she a beaut? Quality stock, rump steak, bacon, onion, real tomato and barbecue sauce. And that's no bull. Domino's!
Who uses new generation Valvoline, you know what I mean.
To make homemade soup or casserole easily, there's only one place to start. Campbell's Real Stock. Homemade, made easy. Look for Campbell's new Real Stock Chef range in two delicious flavors, beef and tomato, and chicken and Italian herbs.
Surfing's World Championship Tour has moved to South Africa, where some wonderful waves put on a reception. The Australians lapped it up at Jeffreys Bay.
The South African leg of the World Tour offers its own unique culture. But as day broke on Jeffreys Bay, another offering of perfect conditions for the world's top surfers. Sydney's Richie Lovett second in his opening round heat. Western Australia's Jake Patterson making the most of the early waves to ride straight into round three. After coming close to the world title last year, Byron Bay's Danny Wills has slipped to number 20 on the world rankings. But after changing back to an 18-month-old board for this event, Wills had a change of luck. A 9-point ride at the famed Super Tubes break.
I'm really comfortable. I feel good after that heat, and I got a good board. This is my faithful. I've had it for about a year and a half now, so I just feel pretty confident.
The 24-year-old didn't make it past round two last year. An easy victory in the opening heat puts him directly into round three.
So I thought, you know, that's the way you're going to win heats is get barreled. So I was sort of hunting for him.
It was a good day for the Aussies. Bo Emmertson impressive, Joel Parkinson and Mark Okolupo both winning their heats.
Back to football now, and Stone, did he drop out or was he thrown out? That's Mick Stone, the NRL's referees director. He denies senior referees instigated his departure. Flanked by NRL officials, Stone was putting on a brave face today, saying it was his decision.
I wasn't forced to quit. No, obviously looking at the things that have happened over the past couple of months, I haven't been terribly happy with the way things have gone in the job.
But he did admit he'd lost the full confidence of coaches and some referees. And after the best part of a decade in the game's thankless job, he was tired of fighting. Another of rugby league's big names has retired. This time it's Paul Langmack. The 33-year-old has quit Sydney City after a disappointing season to make way for younger players. One of the game's great characters, he played 314 first-grade games for Canterbury, Western Suburbs and Sydney City, winning premierships with the Bulldogs. He played four State of Origins and toured Great Britain and France with the 1986 Kangaroos. Good news at last for St Kilda with the return of Brownlow medalist Robert Harvey. He had a calf injury and looked to be no chance earlier in the week, but after a tough fitness test today, he's ready to play.
We're very confident Robert's going to play. It appears that there's no soreness at all in his calf.
Harvey returns as the Saints try to break a three-match losing streak against the red-hot Richmond, which is looking for its third win on the trot. In some other era, Daniel Kowalski might well have attracted higher praise and heavier sponsorship. His record's not bad, it's just that his career has coincided with the rise of a bunch of other great Australian swimmers. But even with injury holding him back, he won't give up on his bid for recognition.
Searching for the answer to nearly 6 years of pain, Daniel Kowalski has risked his greatest dream. But while shoulder surgery has jeopardised his preparations for Sydney 2000, his Olympic desire burns brighter than ever.
We have the Olympics next year. That's the biggest goal for any athlete, and it would be pointless, and it would just seem like a waste of my whole life if I decided just to throw it in because of one little injury.
Kowalski's injury, however, isn't so little. It's kept him out of the water for at least two of the past 4 years, and when he was able to swim, it was in pain.
And particularly in the last 6 months, I've been swimming with a lot of pain, and it's got to the point 3 weeks ago where I couldn't even lift my arm, let alone swim.
An arthroscope this week was Kowalski's last resort. He now faces a race against time to be fit for the Olympic trials.
Things aren't definite that it will all clear up okay, and I haven't ever thought about not swimming at the Olympics.
Driven by the belief he's yet to reach his potential, Kowalski doesn't care that some people have written him off.
Yeah, lots of people have, but I don't think I would sit here and mention names, and they know who they are. But I've been through so much now that I don't have to prove anything to anybody else.
Turning 24 today, Kowalski says after 2000 he'll bow out, whether he swims at the Olympics or not.
And hopefully I can end it all on a high.
Life wasn't meant to be easy for the England cricket captain. The world's most effective speed hump. And they're extremely busy in San Francisco, but drop in anyway.
It's sporting action here on 10 as we catch all the 500cc highlights from the Netherlands. They carve it up in the ASP World Surfing Tour. It's off-road drama in the Australian Rally Championships. Then Bill and Barry bring you the latest with RPM on 10 Sport.
You better get into the fast lane to score this $2,000 deal on Excel. Not only do you get Hyundai's 5-year warranty and power steering, for a limited time you get a $2,000 sports pack free. That's a free spoiler, free CD player, and free alloy wheels. The 1.5-litre twin-cam XL Sports. From just $13,990 drive away, they're going quick smart.
Action Vicks Vapor Drops. No words can express the relief.
Come meet me at the Electric Lady Lounge on Ocean.
Do something! We got a tail!
Driver. Corruption and betrayal ignite in the adrenaline-charged chase of an era. Grab it now on PlayStation.
Man, don't be a... be a driver!
PlayStation!
To make homemade soup or casserole easily, there's only one place to start. Campbell's Real Stock. Homemade made easy. Look for Campbell's new Real Stock Chef range in two delicious flavours, beef and tomato and chicken and Italian herbs.
It is the 31st century and mankind is once again at war. Prepare yourself for the most intense PC gaming experience ever. More missions. More mechs. And all the firepower you need to fight for the future. MechWarrior 3, available on PC CD-ROM.
call 1902-555-612 and you could win a Sporting limited edition 1997 NBA All-Star Weekend Basketball signed by Glenn Rice, John Stockton, Steve Kerr and the participants in the 1997 AT&T Shootout. We also have 10 pre-release PlayStation copies of Konami's exciting new video game NBA Pro 99. Just call for your chance to win thanks to the NBA, GT Interactive and Sports Tonight.
Welcome back. After missing the cut at the US Open, Stuart Appleby is back on the leaderboard at the Western Open, two shots behind the leader, Mike Briskie. Appleby took a week off after the US Open, and it seems now like a good idea as the Victorian carded a 4-under opening round of 68. First round leader Briskie shot an even smarter 6-under 66. Aussies Robert Allenby and Wayne Grady did not break
through. Oh my.
England's new cricket captain, Nasser Hussain, looked destined for a promising start at the helm when his bowlers ripped through New Zealand's top order on day one of the first test at Edgbaston. Andy Caddick took three wickets as New Zealand laboured to 6 for 106 midway through the second session. But an 85-run, seventh wicket stand between Adam Pirori and Dion Nash helped the Kiwis restore the innings. Rory hit a battling 73 as New Zealand reached 226 before the final wicket fell. England in reply, 7 for 56. More extreme action now as the sky surfers spin above San Francisco. Theatrics here from Alex Iadice and Eric Frade. No swell needed up here as the sky surfers did their thing. The guys who are extreme, even for extremists, took to the streets in the dual luge. Dennis de Framelaar survived some underhand tactics from opponent Lee Danzy to win the final. And if there was an award for the most extreme reaction, Dennis would win it. Couldn't agree more. The stars took a back seat today as stuntmen took over in the lead up to the British Motorcycle Grand Prix. It was all part of a charity fundraising day of champions. One brave fan made the ultimate sacrifice, letting a rider use his body as a speed hump. Better than a bike rack, I suppose. While the Grand Prix riders left the tricks to the professionals, they stepped up when it was time to raise money. The fans rewarded for their generosity when organisers allowed them to ride on the circuit. From the best of British, well, this is about as American as it gets. President Clinton and the First Family, among 55,000 who turned out to watch the United States take on Germany at the Women's World Cup, and the locals gave Bill plenty of reasons to cheer. Their fourth straight win at the tournament. Pretty happy US team, 3-2, and they're into the semi-finals against Brazil. To racing, and our tipster Mark Reed has five good things for tomorrow. In Sydney, he likes in race four, number 10, Ningit. That's number 10 in the fourth. To Melbourne, Mark says, try Chiming Door. That's race three, number 2, Chiming Door. In Brisbane, it's Mr. Esteem. That's race three, number 1. Number 1 in the third. Over to Adelaide now. Mark reckons Stylish King will get the money. That's race one, number 3. Race one, number 3. Finally in Perth, the special of the day. Race five, number 9. Sky's the limit. Race five, number 9. To check the latest sports betting, here's Bill Anderson from Sport Odds.
Well, there were some upsets last week in the AFL, which of course is great for us, so maybe it's your turn this time around. Now, coming up, the Kangaroos paying $1.45 take on Brisbane, who will be competitive, but how could you tip against a team that's won 8 straight? St Kilda coming off 3 losses, $1.60. Richmond on a high and right in this, $2.25. West Coast looked the goods at $1.25. Melbourne, $3.50. The punters expect Sydney to turn it around from last week. I'm not as confident. Swans, $1.67. Western Bulldogs, $2.15. Essendon, $1.40. Fremantle, $2.85. Hawthorn Carlton's up for grabs. Take your pick there. And that betting's a fair call for Adelaide Geelong. The Crows, $1.50 dividend. To rugby league, Sydney City, after some indifferent form, have rushed Lamb back into the squad. They're $1.11 away to Wests. The Roosters conceding 16.5 with the points. Despite losing 5 of their last 6, Penrith $1.53, Souths $2.50. It should be a lot closer than that. It's amazing what one win can do. North Queensland $1.55 favourites, Manly $2.40. Canterbury $1.75, the Sharks still underrated $2.05. Newcastle $1.60 against the Bears. Brisbane, after stringing five wins together, $1.07 versus Balmain. A lot of teams are starting to look over their shoulder at the Broncos. They're now into $8 to win the comp. At one stage, they were returning $36. And Canberra, $1.20 against Auckland. Betting to win the Rugby Tri-Nation Series has New Zealand topping the ladder at $2.10, Australia $2.90, South Africa out to $3.25. We'll have more on that next week. For our sport odds tip of the week this week, it's something different. It's a multi-bet combining West Coast and Adelaide in the AFL with Sydney City and South Sydney in the Rugby League. That's paying $5.20. As you know, there's a bank up of matches at Wimbledon because of the weather. We'll be updating our markets overnight. Good luck.
They're very mad.
This bus stealing speed freak.
They're very bad.
Some people think they're above the law because of who they are.
And they're living on the edge.
Man, this is an airspace nightmare.
World's Wildest Police Videos Uncut, 8:30 Saturday.
Looking for the easiest way to get mobile? The answer is Tandy. You'll save $100 on this Motorola on Optus Express prepaid. And with no fixed term contracts and no monthly access fees, it's the easiest way to get mobile. Tandy Electronics. You've got questions, we've got answers.
Liven up your party with Pizza Haven's Life of the Party Pack. For just $18.95, we'll come around to your place with any three large pizzas. So ring now and invite us over.
For your Pizza Haven, call up Pizza Haven tonight.
Home and contents insurance you can pay by the month.
At last somebody understands.
No excess on claims. New for old replacement of home and contents, regardless of age.
Fantastic.
Free legal advice. If you're over 55 and no longer working full-time, there is a company that gives you understanding, not just insurance.
That's all we want.
Call Australian Pensioners Insurance Agency on 132555. 24 hours, 7 days a week.
7 days a week? See, they do understand.
There's a better life at the Home Buyer Center. You can own your dream home now with absolutely no deposit. That's right, no deposit. It's the first genuine no deposit offer ever to hit WA. Call 131-751 now. Offer is limited.
Girl, there's a better life for me and you.
It's vitally important that electric shock victims are treated immediately. In an emergency, every second counts. Channel 10 urges you to call St John Ambulance now and learn first aid. All it takes is 3 hours and $30.
Welcome back, and we'll just update the scores from Wimbledon. Tough match for Pat Rafter, 5-all in the fourth. He had a break down and he has managed to scramble back. Very difficult one against Todd Martin. Yelena Dokic, though, has squared up the match against Stevenson. And just repeating, if you didn't catch the early news, Mark Philippoussis was leading a set to love against Pete Sampras. Unfortunately, had an injured knee and had to retire. He's had that checked in hospital. No result yet. It's about time we enjoyed some amazing pictures of sporting highlights with clever commentary and wacky one-liners. Nah, let's see the plays of the week instead.
Takeoff time in the NASCARs.
And we have a car into the tire barriers.
It's a one-way wheelie. Golf shot of the week came from a blind golfer, Worth Dalton. From the We'll Take All Steps to Ensure We've Got It Covered department. Remember that corner.
Oh, another car up on the wall. There's Ken Schrader.
No fun on this bend either.
Oh, target down. It had to happen. He lost the front earlier. He lost the rear earlier. Now he's lost the block completely.
Best acrobatic goal with points awarded for difficulty.
She's got two.
Best sporting comeback of the week. Just best comeback, full stop.
Hey! The King and Wonder Woman.
Not enough room for this bloke to swing a cat, let alone a bat.
And Ricky Rodden! Racetrack. Oh my goodness, hard contact.
They're still having a really good time. And not everybody was good at doing tricks.
Oh.
Yes, for some, it just wasn't a good week.
This is what's called a snap. Look out.
That's it, Friday, July 2. I'm Bill Woods. Good night.